That's just joining. We're extremely lucky to have Dr. Lopez tonight. Dr. Lopez did his PM&R training down at University of Kentucky, and now he's up at Kessler Rutgers New Jersey Medical School in New Jersey, doing a spinal cord injury fellowship. And we're super lucky to have him, and he's going to talk to us a little bit about the basics of spinal cord injury, and then maybe in the future we'll have him back to go a little bit more in depth. So I'm going to turn it over to him, and he said if you want to ask questions in the chat, you feel free to do that, or if you want to unmute yourself and ask questions as well. So I'll turn it over to you, Dr. Lopez. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you. I'm really happy to be here. I appreciate everyone joining. I see a bunch of names that I know. So, you know, thanks for taking time out of your busy day. I know it's hectic with applications, and I'm sure you've got step exams and all kinds of exams. So appreciate you being here. I'm hoping we can learn a few things together, hopefully get excited about a topic that I'm definitely excited about. I wanted to give a special thanks to George because I know this is, you know, it's hard to run a social media account, and I've been following the PM&R scholars for a while, and everyone's doing awesome work helping with virtual tours and trying to network and you know, be part of this physiatry team. So keep it up. Thank you, George, for inviting me. Today, before, like George said, I'm happy to answer any questions through the chat. I have that open right now. Actually, I'm going to send out my email at some point towards the end, and maybe my Twitter handle, if you want to reach out that way. You can ask me about spinal cord injury, residency, fellowship, whatever. I'm here for you guys. I'm here to help you. So I did do my training at University of Kentucky. I am one of the current spinal cord fellows at Kessler. I did my medical school at an osteopathic school in Glendale, Arizona. That was Midwestern University. And I completed my undergraduate studies at LSU. So go Tigers. I always got to make sure I get that in, especially now with a whole lot of sports now. So what we're going to be talking about today is a broad topic, right? It's introduction to spinal cord injury. So before we really get into it, I want to let you know what I want you to take away from this. And let me actually close this out. I want you to, while we're talking, like really try and focus on what a spinal cord injury patient goes through, what the person has to deal with after they get this devastating injury. It impacts all aspects of their life, you know, their mental health, their physical health, their physiologic health. And as we move through the different topics, I want you to try and put yourself in their shoes and maybe what they're going through. Because a lot of these patients, unfortunately, get labeled as, you know, the guy in the wheelchair or the girl with the spinal cord injury. And I want you to take away how difficult it can be to live with a spinal cord injury, but then also recognize what we as physiatrists and future physiatrists can do to change these people's lives and help them. So when you think about spinal cord injury, you know, it doesn't impact as many people as cancer or heart disease, but the population it impacts is small but very significant. The population we're talking about, and everything I'm going to cover is really focused on traumatic spinal cord injury. So a traumatic event leading to the injury. That's what these statistics show here. So approximately 18,000 people in the United States get a traumatic spinal cord injury every year. And that means there's about 300,000 people in the United States living with a spinal cord injury. And like I mentioned, this injury itself can result in just devastating changes to their life. It can impact the person themselves, the social support system, like their family, their friends, their coworkers, the hospital systems. There's large finances involved, and it just changes your whole life. And one of the ways we're going to show that is through a couple of videos, both good and bad, I guess. So the gentleman you see on the right here, this is Ryan Shazier. He is currently still under contract with the Pittsburgh Steelers. He's a professional football player who had an unbelievably promising career, and that's someone coming from someone who isn't a fan of the Steelers at all. Unfortunately, in his fourth year of playing in the NFL, he made a very routine tackle, had excellent form, but things did not go well after that tackle, and he was paralyzed from about the waist down. The actual injury itself is slightly unclear for HIPAA reasons, but he underwent stabilization surgery and was left with an incomplete lumbar spinal cord injury. He fortunately had access to a great medical team and underwent some very intense rehab, but this injury changed his life forever. right? He went from being a Pro Bowl athlete and trying to win Super Bowls to just trying to stand up at his wedding and having a goal of walking across the stage at the Emmys. His goal now in 2020 is to return to playing football. And when you hear that, you think, how the heck could that happen? But this is what Ryan Shazier looks like now, 3 or so years after his injury. So clearly he had a spinal cord injury because we know that's what happened, but it was probably classified as an ASIA impairment scale D, and we'll talk about what that means later. But this is an example of someone who could not walk, who could not move his legs, and is now jumping on a 30-inch box. So recovery does happen. Is he the same as he was? No. Will he play football again? Time will tell. But people do get better after these injuries, and that's an important thing to take away, and I want people to recognize that. So kind of what we're going to go through in this is just a brief overview of anatomy and how it relates to spinal cord injuries. And we're going to talk about epidemiology, but not necessarily numbers. We want to look at more of who is it that's getting injured? Who are the patients and the people that we're taking care of as spinal cord physicians? Well, we're going to kind of talk about what is life like? What are the side effects and the repercussions of having a spinal cord injury, and how does it change you and your social system? Next, we're going to move into just a very brief intro to the International Standards and Neurologic Classification of Spinal Cord Injury. That's the INSCI exam, or the Spinal Cord Injury exam. That is a whole lecture in and of itself. So if anybody has questions about how to score an exam or how to do the test, feel free to reach out to me afterwards and I'll be happy to discuss it. And then we're going to kind of finish up with what is the role of physiatry and how do we as spinal cord experts help patients with spinal cord injury, and then where's the cure going to be? What's the future look like? And talk about some of the ways that we are going to help patients in the future. So for me, when I think of spinal cord anatomy and I think of what the heck the spinal cord actually is, it's important to really recognize that this is an extension of your brain. Your spinal cord is connected to your brain through the medulla oblongata. It exits your cranium through the foramen magnum and then enters into the vertebral column through the atlas. In the medulla is where the majority of the decussation or crossing over of fibers happen. And you know, when you look at pictures of the spinal cord, everything's very artistic, and I think you just, sometimes it's easy to get lost in what the topic is. What is the spinal cord actually? And the spinal cord extends from the medulla down to the conus medullaris. The conus is like the end of the spinal cord. And the spinal cord proper only consists of that segment. And you can see in this cadaver a beautifully done dissection. Hopefully anybody gets to experience a cadaver like this, because I sure have not seen any. The area we're talking about is just from the medulla to the conus medullaris. And in an adult, that only measures about 17 or so inches. So if you're 6'4", it's not like your spinal cord is 5 feet long. It took me a long time to really recognize that the size and the area of what we're talking about. So just as an example of what 17 inches is, if you were to take your elbow crease and draw a line or take a ruler from your elbow crease to the tips of some of your fingers, that's about 17 inches. It's a small structure. And when you think about all the functions the spinal cord does and all of the different pathways within the spinal cord, things are packed in there very tight. As you can see in this photo, there's this extension. It looks like, like a collection of spaghetti. This is called the cauda equina, and that's an extension of the spinal cord. It's not part of the spinal cord itself. It's spinal nerves that exit the spinal cord and innervate your lower extremities. And I kind of want people to just take a second and look at this picture. You can see in the thoracic spine where the ribs are, it's very uniform in size. That size, if you've ever done a cadaver or a dissection, is, you know, about the size, like the width of one of your fingers, usually your small finger. But if you look up in the neck area, the cervical spine is much larger, and that's called the cervical enlargement. You also have one down in the lumbosacral region called the lumbosacral enlargement. And I point those out because these are the areas that have innervation to your limbs. And those areas get larger because there's a huge number of neurons that are needed to move your arms and legs. You know, it takes a lot of neurons to be able to feel the keyboard of a piano and then play it. Whereas it doesn't take nearly as many neurons to just have light touch sensation on your abdomen, or you know, perform an abdominal crunch. So the areas in the cervical and lumbosacral spine get way bigger. And you can see on this picture on the left that the spinal cord is not homogeneous throughout. It changes in size and shape. And when you start getting into, you know, you get into your residency and you start seeing spinal cord injury patients, when you find out where their injury is, think about what structures are actually getting injured and how that's impacting them, right? That's, you know, you always got to figure out why is the patient behaving this way? Why do they have these deficits? And we're going to try and talk about some of that going forward. So, you know, you do have some, the spinal cord is very delicate, but you have some very robust protection in your vertebral column. The vertebral column has itself 33 vertebrae or 33 bones in it. And those bones are, particularly in the thoracolumbar region, are strong, dense bones that can absorb a lot of force. So it takes a lot of force to cause a spinal cord injury in your lumbar spine. You have these ligaments that run along the anterior and posterior surface of the vertebrae, the vertebral bodies, and these ligaments prevent, you know, your spine from flexing too much or extending too much. And because too much flexion extension itself can lead to an injury, you can get a hyperflexion injury, get a fracture of a bone, and then that fracture can retropulse or shoot back into the spinal canal and cause an injury. Now, the unfortunate thing is these same protection mechanisms, the bones and the ligaments, you know, the ligaments can get thickened and hypertrophied, the bones can get posterior osteophytes, and the same things that are supposed to protect you actually can lead to decreasing of the space in the spinal canal, and they can push on the spinal canal themselves. So just because it's a shield or a defense mechanism doesn't mean it's perfect and always keeps you protected. I'm covering blood flow for a few reasons. One is because it's challenging. It's very, very challenging. So I wanted to introduce you to the blood flow of the spinal cord now. So as you progress through your residency, and if you decide to do a spinal cord fellowship, it's not new to you. And it's challenging because it's not uniform from person to person. There are general trends and there are some similarities, but me compared to so-and-so and somebody else can have very different patterns of vasculature in your spinal cord. So we're gonna keep it simple, okay? So in your spine, the majority of the blood flow, or nearly all of the blood flow, is supplied by these three longitudinally oriented arteries. Those are the anterior spinal artery and the posterior spinal arteries, plural. Now, the anterior spinal artery is one large artery that supplies the anterior two-thirds of the spinal cord. So I want you to remember one artery and anterior two-thirds of the cord. You also then have two posterior spinal arteries, and those supply the posterior one-third of the spinal cord with blood. So two arteries, one-third. And this is important to recognize because these areas, these arteries have many small branching segments and radicular arteries, and they carry blood flow to the rootlets and different areas. And this is where it starts to get complicated because there are many small arteries. And I want to bring all this up to recognize some of the problems that can occur with the vasculature. So despite there being a system of checks and balances and you have collateral blood flow, there are areas that are at risk they're at risk of having low blood flow to them. So those areas in particular are gonna be right around what's highlighted in the T1 to T4 area, and then right around T9-ish, T9 and T10. These areas are known as watershed areas or watershed regions. And when the blood pressure in the body gets low, you get really bad hypotension. That can lead to hypoperfusion of these areas. And you might think, well, you know, how often does that really happen? And unfortunately, in spinal cord medicine, this is something you actually see a lot. So this isn't classified as a traumatic spinal cord injury. And just in the couple months I've been in fellowship, I have seen more than one of these types of injuries. And I wanted to highlight one of those patients in particular because this can be hard for people to understand. Like, wait a second, my blood pressure didn't get that low. Why would it be causing a spinal cord injury? So there was a patient I took care of recently. He was a middle-aged man who was very healthy. No past medical history, no medications that he took. He ran multiple miles per day. Very vibrant life and vivacious. And the only real history he ever had was back pain with radiculopathy and radiating back pain. And he underwent a lumbar fusion, like, you know, 9 or 10 years ago, and it went great. It was L4 and 5 fusion. There was no problems. He was up and running again, and he was happier than he's ever been. And a few months ago, he started having recurrence of his back pain and recurrence of the radicular pain. So him and his surgeon discussed, well, maybe we should extend the fusion, which is fairly common. It's fairly common for the level above your fusion to get worn out. So they decided to proceed with an extension of the lumbar fusion, and he underwent surgery. And when he came out of surgery, he couldn't move his legs. And he also couldn't really feel around his belly button, around his umbilicus, and he was having a bunch of sensory changes. So a huge workup ensued, imaging, labs, consults, all of it, rightfully so. And on the imaging, the neurosurgeon saw that there was an abnormality or hyper intensity at the T9 region. And when the neurosurgeon went through all the images with the radiologist, they felt that this was most consistent with an infarct or lack of blood flow to the T9 area. And for better or worse, the patient was given a ton of information, and some of that information may have led the patient to believe that maybe it wasn't a spinal cord infarct. Maybe it was an inflammatory process or a spasm of the artery or whatever information he was given. So when he came to rehab, he was expecting this aha moment or this magic pill or something we had to offer, or something somebody had to offer to fix this. And unfortunately, that just isn't the case. So what happened was he did have relatively low blood pressure during the surgery. And that surgery is usually measured, you know, on your arm, like if you go to the doctor and get your blood pressure. And just because your blood pressure is relatively okay there doesn't mean it's okay in these small arteries of your spinal cord. So we felt as a team that it was fairly clear cut that he had had a hypoperfusion spinal cord infarct. And it took a long time for the patient to even begin to recognize that as a possibility. And he was always holding out for something else, a magic pill, like I said. And he had a tough rehab course and unfortunately had a lot of complications and wasn't able to finish his rehab stay. He had to go back to the acute care hospital. But I just want you to recognize that this does happen. Infarcts do happen, and not everyone in medicine fully understands how. And we as spinal cord experts and physiatrists and rehab physicians need to understand this. So as you progress in your training, learning what blood flow is all about and how it impacts patients is very important. The next kind of basic anatomy thing we want to talk about is the spinal nerve. So you've got 31 pairs of spinal nerves, and this is the beginning of the peripheral nervous system. So these spinal nerves, they're mixed. They carry sensory, they carry motor, they carry autonomics. And, you know, they're your connection with from your spinal cord to the rest of the world. And these spinal nerves exit the spinal cord and exit the vertebral column through the intervertebral foramina. Now, I'm going to show this is one of the more important slides from the anatomy. I want the students to really focus in on this because this is something you get tested on. You can get asked questions about from your attendings, particularly on surgical resident, surgical rotations. And naming or numbering the spinal nerves is very important. It can come into play when you are discussing disc herniations and what nerve would be impacted. It can come into play when you're looking at imaging and trying to figure out which nerve root is going to be impacted. So all the spinal nerves in the cervical region exit above their corresponding vertebrae. So the C1 spinal nerve exits above the C1 vertebrae. The C4 spinal nerve exits above the C4 vertebrae. The C8 spinal nerve exits above the T1 vertebrae. Now, the way I remember this is your cervical region is above the rest of your spine and everything else is below it. And everything else below, all the other spinal nerves are named for the corresponding vertebrae below it. For example, T1 comes out under or below the T1 vertebrae. The T10 spinal nerve comes out below the T10 vertebrae. So if I believe, yeah, George is recording this. This is something you might want to go back to and really try and get this down, because it can get you easy points on your tests and your in-service exams, and you know, make you look very knowledgeable to different attendings that you rotate with. So this is a very, very important concept. This next slide kind of looks at how do these spinal nerves exit? And like I said, they exit the intervertebral foramina, but the more important thing on this slide is we want to start to look at what most people think of when you hear the word spinal cord anatomy, and that's this cross section of the spinal cord. You can see there's a very classic butterfly shape and surrounded by white matter, and you know, does it really look like that? And the answer is yes, it does. It the drawings depict that fairly well. When you get into your cadavers, really look closely in the cross section, you can see images that look a lot like this. So the central butterfly is made of gray matter, which has neurons and different neuron support cells, and the white matter are these long peripheral tracts that have ascending and descending fibers that are myelinated, so the signal travels very, very fast. And these myelinated axons are what give it that white color. So I just like to start looking at what spinal cords actually look like. But when you hear the term spinal cord anatomy and cross section, you might start to sweat and get nervous. And that's because you think of pictures that look like this. And this can be a daunting thing to try and learn and memorize and remember where the different tracts are and which tract does what. And don't worry, we're not going to go through all of it. We're going to break it down and keep it simple. But just like everything else in anatomy and in the body, this is not what the spinal cord looks like. It's not labeled like Netter's. It's not as easy as that. It unfortunately looks like this. So if you see a spinal cord, or if you see an image, an MRI image, this is going to be what it looks like. It's going to have an injury to a certain area, and you have to figure out what is going to be the deficit. So when I think about spinal cord anatomy, I like to try and kind of mesh the picture I just showed you and this one. And that ends up looking something like this, right? A combination of histology and drawing. So like we talked about already, there's a bunch of tracts, many, 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 many tracts with many, many, many different features and functions. So for me, keeping anatomy simple is how I can most easily understand it. So what I've done is highlighted three very important tracts, three of the more clinically relevant tracts, because these are the tracts that you primarily test when you do your spinal cord examination. So what we have highlighted in green here is a descending tract. That's the corticospinal tract. So that goes from your cortex down your spinal cord and to the muscle. This is involved in motor function and movement. So when you have a thought on the right side of your brain, you say, I want to move my left arm, that signal travels from your motor cortex to your medulla. It crosses over to the left side of your spinal cord, left side of your spinal cord, and then you can move your arm. This is what is responsible for all of your voluntary motor activity. Just simplify it by thinking of this is where voluntary motor activity comes from. When you injure this, you get weakness. And when you injure this, you can get an upper motor neuron syndrome. So when you do the spinal cord examination, part of the test is a motor test. This is what you're testing, okay? And if this is injured or this is damaged, you have weakness. You are not as strong as you were. So corticospinal tract, motor, very simple. The next one we're gonna look at is the one that's highlighted in red. This is the posterior column. Now, the posterior column is an ascending tract, meaning it takes information from the periphery and carries it up the spinal cord to the brain so you can perceive a sensation. So what the posterior or the dorsal column carries is kinesthesia and discriminant touch. And those are things like proprioception, vibration, two-point discrimination. But the big one, the one I want you to focus on, is proprioception. So if someone moves your foot, that signal, so let's say someone moves your right foot, that signal of movement travels up the peripheral nerves to the spinal cord. It goes all the way up the spinal cord on the same right side as your foot. It crosses over in the medulla. It goes to the left side of your somatosensory cortex, and you perceive that your foot has moved. So if this area gets injured, your dorsal column or your posterior column, you have a big problem with proprioception. You can't tell where your limbs are in space. And it doesn't matter if you have 5 out of 5 strength, you are perfect strength when you're laying in the bed. If you get out of bed and you can't tell where your legs are, it's gonna be extremely difficult to walk. It's gonna be extremely difficult to move your legs in a coordinated fashion because you can't tell where they are. So when people get injuries to this posterior column, it's got poor prognosis for walking. And that's one thing that many spinal cord patients initially care the most about. So posterior column injury leads to proprioception problems. That's the key take home here. The next one highlighted in red on the left is the spinothalamic tract. And this one's a little bit more, complicated. That's why I saved it for last. So this is responsible for pain, transmission of pain sensation and temperature, as well as a little bit of a light touch. But a lot of these tracts have multi-function. So we're gonna think about pain and temperature. So this is also an ascending tract. So let's say someone takes an ice cube and puts it on my ankle, on my left foot, my left ankle. That signal is gonna travel up my peripheral nerves, through the spinal nerves, into the spinal cord. And instead of traveling all the way up and then crossing, like the previous two tracts we talked about, it's gonna cross right at the level, very close to the level that corresponds to my ankle. Then it will travel up the right side of my spinal cord, synapse in my brain, and I will perceive that someone put an ice cube, a cold sensation on my foot. Now, that delineation of where it crosses is, it's important when you talk about like incomplete spinal cord syndromes and Brown Saccard. And we're not gonna go into that. I'm happy to discuss those later if those are a challenge for you. But like I said, feel free to reach out with those. So the key takeaway here is if you damage your spinothalamic tract, you cannot feel pain or temperature. And that comes into play in spinal cord injury patients. If they're laying in one position for 5 hours and they develop a pressure injury, they can't feel it. Now, you don't injure these tracts necessarily individually. You injure them, potentially all of them, in a traumatic spinal cord injury. So you get a smattering of all of the things we just talked about. So it's not like you just lose weakness or you just lose sensation. It affects everything, and those effects can have very negative impacts on the patient. So that's kind of all the anatomy I wanted to review. If there's no questions, we're gonna move on to the next area, and this is epidemiology, but like I said before, we wanna focus on who are the people that we're taking care of. What are they like? So when we look at this first slide here, you can see that this is the number, this is the percentage of breakdown of different sexes that get traumatic spinal cord injuries. The number is actually about 78% of traumatic spinal cord injuries are male. Now, I'll pose this to the audience. If we don't get an answer in a couple seconds, I'll answer it. But does anybody have any thoughts on why men might be more likely to get spinal cord injuries? All right, so men are probably more likely to take risky activities. I've got a couple answers coming in on the chat. Excellent, that is exactly right. So men are more likely to do risky activity. They might drive fast, they might go off-roading, they might do very impulsive behaviors. And that's just unfortunately a side effect of being a male sometimes. So when the men do these risky behaviors, that puts them at an increased risk of getting the traumatic spinal cord injury. So that is a primary reason as why men are more likely to get traumatic spinal cord injuries. There's also evidence and research that shows estrogen has a neuroprotective component. And if women were to have the same traumatic event, estrogen may protect them so that they don't get the spinal cord injury. But the key take home here is guys take more risks, and those risks lead to spinal cord injury. The other image on the screen looks at the age. So in 2020, the average age of a traumatic spinal cord injury patient is 43 years old. That's been that way for 5 years. It has not changed much. But when you look back 50 years ago, the number wasn't even 29. So again, you're welcome to send me your chat as to why you think this might be happening. Why has the average age of a spinal cord injury increased so dramatically over the last 50 years? Good, got a couple answers coming in. Those are correct. So we as a medical society have gotten way better at stabilizing and reviving patients. So back in the 1970s, getting a cervical level spinal cord injury did not have good outcomes. People unfortunately passed away from these much more frequently than they do today. In particular, older folks with more medical comorbidities would be more likely to pass away. So back in the 1970s, if a 60-year-old or a 70 or 80-year-old sustained a spinal cord injury, they might not survive it. Whereas nowadays, we are able to not only have them survive, but have better outcomes. So that is one reason. Another reason is in the 21st century, people are living longer than they were in the 1970s. And as people mature in life and become older, they become slightly more frail. And as people age, they might fall. So older folks who fall, they are now much older than 29 years old. They fall and they get a spinal cord injury. And those same folks who are now aging have some characteristics that predispose them to the injury. Like we talked about before, they can get cervical stenosis, and they can get myelopathy, and then when they fall, the already compressed spinal cord gets compressed even more, and now they have a spinal cord injury, and they are 70 when they have it. So those are the factors that have increased the average age of spinal cord injury. And the next thing I want to cover is, like, well, how do you get spinal cord injuries, right? We talked about who gets them, but how do you get them? Accidents, car accidents, vehicle accidents. That is definitely number one. It's been that way forever. Falls have come much closer in the percentage of reasons you get a spinal cord injury. But the test answer, the real life answer, is motor vehicle accidents. People drive fast, they get in high speed, high trauma, high force accidents, and they get spinal cord injuries. As you can see with the pie chart, falls are the second most common. And that again has to do with people living longer, people falling, and already having characteristics that predispose them to injury. And then you can see the breakdown of other causes, violence, followed by sports, and then medical, surgical, and a few of the others. So about 60% of patients who get injured sustain an injury to their neck, and that results in weakness of all four limbs, or tetraplegia. On the flip side of that, about 40% of them have paraplegia, or just weakness of their lower extremities. Now, the pie chart in the bottom right-hand corner, can that's a little bit in there more for the residents. I want you know, this is a very testable question. So the question can be asked, what is the most common type of spinal cord injury? And that's gonna be incomplete tetraplegia. So just tuck this away, remember it. The key thing is vehicles followed by falls, and that tetraplegia is more common than paraplegia. So now we've kind of covered what areas of the spinal cord get injured. We've talked about who gets injured. This is the most important part of the whole talk. What is it like having a life with spinal cord injury? Until you meet a spinal cord injury patient and follow them from the beginning of the rehab course and see them at maybe their first follow-up, it's hard to recognize the impact it has on someone's life. So the first thing we're gonna look at is some different characteristics. So this graph I'm gonna show you is gonna progress through time, with the first data point being at the time of injury. So when people first get injured, more than, 70 or so percent of them are employed. A third of them are married, but I want you to focus on how this changes over time. So the next slide is gonna show you what the statistics are at 1 year. And you can see that the employment rate below 25%. Not much changes in people's relationships necessarily at this time, but when you jump forward to 10 years after your spinal cord injury, employment's not going to change a whole lot, but watch the divorce rate. It's going to change big time. And this has to do with, you know, everyone says death do us part and for better or worse, but being a primary caregiver for someone with a spinal cord injury is challenging. It's a lot of physical effort. It's mentally taxing to see someone you love go through this life-altering experience. So as we progress, this is going to next go into 20 years, and you see that more and more people get employed, slightly more people get divorced. And if you're fortunate enough to live 30 years out, people start getting married again, and those marriages are very strong. If people get married with this, they already have a spinal cord injury and they get married, those marriages last. So as we move to 40 years, you can see that the rate of married folks does increase. And this just shows that over time, people can live very happy, fulfilling, and healthy lives with a spinal cord injury. So this is a not comprehensive list of all of the things that can be a side effect or can be impacted when you have a spinal cord injury. And when you start to look at this list, I hope you can recognize that every single part of the body is impacted. The bowel, the bladder, the skin, the bones, the blood pressure, the everything. Okay, so we as spinal cord physicians and spinal cord physiatrists are truly a unique subset and subspecialty of physiatry. We are responsible for managing all of the things you see on the screen. And to understand these is, all of these takes a lot of effort, but more importantly, it takes, you have to care, you have to give something. And one of the reasons I care about spinal cord injury is a lot of medical professions aren't aware of all the things on this screen, and they aren't aware of the impact that it has on patients. And I knew from pretty early on in my career that I wanted to be able to answer the questions that people with a spinal cord injury have. And if I didn't know the answer, I wanted to know where and how to find it. And if there wasn't an answer to how to fix these things, I wanted to work on a way to make an answer, to find the research, to do that, to put in the work, to put in the time, to find out how we can make people's lives better. So we're going to touch on a few of these, some of the more profound side effects of spinal cord injury. And you know, the biggest one, when you're doing your inpatient rotations, you're going to see it all the time. Everyone talks about bowel and bladder. But what happens when someone goes home, right? While they're inpatient, we have all these tips and tricks. But when someone goes home, neurogenic bowel and the repercussions of that are profound. Bowel accidents and incontinence play a huge role in the life of a patient with spinal cord injury. The fear that people have of having an accident while in public can be crippling. It can prevent them from even wanting to see their friends. It can prevent them from having social interactions because they're afraid that they're going to have an accident and then have to deal with everything that goes with it, the stigma, being made fun of, whatever it may be. And that can, I don't know how it feels, but I know how the patients feel when they talk about it. And it can change their mental health forever by just having a couple of these accidents. So this topic of neurogenic bowel is beyond important. It affects the patient's mental health. It affects their physiologic health. It can lead to bowel obstructions. It affects their physical health. It can lead to skin breakdown and wounds. And, you know, this is a very, 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 very important way that physiatry can intervene and help spinal cord patients. It is our job to determine what type of neurogenic bowel they have. Is it upper or motor neuron? And design and implement a strategy so that patients can control when they have a bowel movement. Because in spinal cord injury, a spinal cord patient can't control their external sphincter, so they don't get to decide, oh, I'm ready to have a bowel movement, let's go now. It happens when the body wants it to. So through various medications and maneuvers and suppositories, the patient can take control of their life and decide when they're going to have a bowel movement. And giving patients that control can be life-changing. So when you get a call and from the nurse or the patient's complaining about bowels, like don't blow it off in anybody, but particularly in the spinal cord population, this is the one, this is the life-altering one, you know. on that same note, the neurogenic bile is the same way. People don't want to be out having dinner with their friends and have a bladder accident and deal with things that their friends are going to say, oh, what's that smell? Or, you know, so as a physiatrist, teaching patients the importance of bladder management, performing a catheter schedule on a schedule, how to do it, when to do it, why to do it, are all ways that we as physiatrists and future physiatrists can change the lives of these patients. And this is just two of the biggest ones, the bowel and bladder. You know, we have a way to help them and give some part of their life back, because a lot of control in their life has been taken away. And I think it's very, very important to recognize how important giving them control back is. Some of the other side effects that are very important is this topic of neuropathic pain or pain in general. The pain that comes with a spinal cord injury can be just debilitating, and that severe pain can lead to patients not having a social life. It can lead to patients not performing therapy and then having more down the line side effects and repercussions. It can lead to patients having to take all kinds of medications that alter their how they think and how they interact with others. And the pain component can drive people crazy and make them depressed. So we need to recognize that. And in this population or any population, not blow off the pain, figure out what is the pain and try different medications and modalities to improve that pain. Because this, again, is one of the things that can change their life forever, forever, forever if they're in pain. And if no one's there to help their pain, they will continue to be in pain. The next one that I, as a physiatrist and a fellow, get extremely excited about, and most people in PM&R do, is spasticity. So this is a way that we have a unique footprint in medicine, that we are experts in spasticity management. We can diagnose it, we can figure out how to improve it, and we can help try and prevent it in the future. So spasticity and upper motor neuron issues following spinal cord are huge, the hugest, the biggest, right? Spasticity impacts every aspect. If you have strength, the spasticity can mask the strength. It can cause contractures, which can be painful. It can cause skin breakdown. It can lead to other things on this list, like heterotopic ossification. It's vitally important to manage patient spasticity. And we, as physiatrists, have a huge toolbox, right? This can consist of instructing patients and therapists to perform different modalities to try and diminish their spasticity. There is a plethora of oral medications that we, as physiatrists, get to prescribe to decrease spasticity. There's botulinum toxin injections, most notably Botox and Dysport and Xeomin. These are all things you can inject to decrease the spasticity. There's intrathecal baclofen and pump delivery systems that we are the experts in, right? This is something that's unique to us. We are the experts in pumps. You know, most people don't know what to do. They hear, oh, they've got a pump, call PM&R. And that is a great feeling to have, to know that we are in control and we can have a measurable impact on people's lives. Now, there are other things to manage spasticity, like electrical stimulation, and we'll touch on that a little bit later. The last thing we're going to talk about in living with a spinal cord injury is something that unfortunately kind of gets blown over and is probably one of the top three biggest reasons I wanted to do a spinal cord injury fellowship, is how the heck do we manage a patient's sexuality and the sexual dysfunction that they have. So after a spinal cord injury, men can have erectile dysfunction, women can have issues with lubrication, and they have these questions that many people don't know how to answer. Spinal cord injury patients can have kids, right? So we need to figure out, what are their goals? How do we help them realize their goals and get them to their goals? We need to be there to answer the difficult questions. And sometimes the patients aren't always gonna come out and say, hey doc, I got a question about sex. It's never gonna be that easy. So an example would be, I recently took care of a very young patient in his teens who had a thoracic level spinal cord injury. And he was just a great kid. And he was very reluctant to ask any questions, but had asked no questions about his sexual health and sexual future. And as he neared the end of his inpatient rehab stay, And I kept asking him every day, like, hey, bud, you have any questions? Is there anything I can answer for you? And he never had any. Until like the third to last day he was there, he pointed out to me a stain on his shorts. And he said, oh, that's toothpaste. Don't worry. I wasn't doing anything funny. And I said, oh, dude, it's all good. And he said, I wish I could do it, though. And I didn't recognize what he was talking about at first. And he was clearly talking about masturbation. And after I replayed the conversation in my mind, I thought, oh, my gosh, he's asking for help. He wants to discuss this topic. And after discussing it with him, but both myself and the attending I'm working with, we had a very open conversation about his prognosis for sexual function, ways in the future that we can help him if it's needed. And you could see that the relief on his face, knowing that A, he might be able to do the things he wants, but B, that someone was there to help him and listen. And that is so much about what this specialty is about, is being there and having an answer. And then if you don't have it, find it. So those are kind of the things, the main things that can be impacted in spinal cord injury. A lot of that can be sad and can be emotionally taxing, but it's not all like that. So I'm going to show you a video. And this video is going to highlight three different patients with spinal cord injury. And these people have different levels of injury. And I want you to focus on what their day-to-day life is. Like, these people can do everything that we can do. They just have to learn different ways to do it. So look at their facial expressions. Try and pay attention to the different equipment that they have, the different adaptive equipment they had. And these are all things that really get me excited. These are things that patients get to go home with and live with for the rest of their lives. So take a couple minutes. It's about 2 minutes long. I just want you to appreciate the other side of life with a spinal cord injury. This guy has a pretty awesome adaptive equipment for his vehicle. And those little side effects, and I didn't do any of that editing, so it was just made that way. So that is what life with a spinal cord injury can be like. It can be happy, it can be healthy, it can be fulfilling, you can have a family, you can be independent. So it's not all doom and gloom. So I just want you to take that away, that although it's profoundly impacts these patients, we can help them. I promise you we can help them. So the next part we're going to talk about is the intro to the spinal cord examination, or the INSCI examination. So INSCI stands for International Standards of Neurologic Classification of Spinal Cord Injury. And this is a way that we can obtain a baseline on a patient, prognosticate a patient's potential recovery, and communicate with other healthcare providers the type of injury a patient has. So for anybody who has not seen it, this is what the INSCI examination looks like. It can be very daunting the first couple times you see it. In the center, you can see a dermatome map that marks out all the sensory locations you're going to test. And a couple things I wanted to point out, the right and left side is anatomic. So you can see on the screen, it's labeled right and left. All of the information you need is on this test, on this sheet. Where to test, how to score, and how to grade. There is a backside to this that I did not include. And you can obtain this version of the INSCI examination very easily by literally just typing in INSCI exam. And I would type 2019 after it, because this has been revised in 2019. So the exam itself has three main portions. That's the motor exam. And the motor exam consists of 10 myotomes on each side of the body. And this is your typical scoring that you think of when you're doing a strength test. That's graded 0 to 5. We don't use any pluses and minuses in the INSCI exam because that starts to become very subjective. It is, can you do the movement that gets you to the next level or not? Also wanted to point out, this test is performed supine with the patient lying down, so it's reproducible. That is the whole goal, is to have reproducible exams that can be used for the things I talked about earlier, plus research purposes. So the next part of the exam is the sensory portion of the exam. We test both light touch and pinprick or sharp dull discrimination. That's over 28 dermatomes on each side of the body. The scoring for this is on a 0 to 2 basis. 0 being absent, 2 being normal, and 1 being not normal. Now that not normal can be, you feel the sensation too little or too much. So light touch is completed with the use of a Q-tip, and all the sensory testing is compared to your cheek or your face as the normal. So you have the patient, you tell them, this is gonna be a light touch examination and this is normal. And then you go through each of those 28 dermatomes on each side and ask them, does this feel the same as your face? If the answer is yes, it's a 2. If the answer is I don't feel it, it's a 0. And if it's, I feel it, but it's less than my face, it's a 1. That's the very, very basics of how to score it. For sharp dull discrimination, you can use just a standard safety pin. The safety pin allows you to have a sharp portion and a dull portion, and it makes the exam very easy. Again, that is compared to your face. And the key part of this exam is, of the pinprick exam, is they have to feel sharp. It can't be, yeah, doc, I feel it, but it's dull or it's pressure. So you compare it to their face and say, does this feel like your face? And if they say, yes, it's as sharp as my face, that's a 2. If they say, I don't feel sharp at all, I just feel pressure, but I feel it. If they don't feel any sharp, it's a 0. The next part's a little bit trickier to describe, but if they say, I feel it's sharp, but it's less than my face, you need to do a sharp dull discrimination test and tell them, tell me which one of these is sharp, number 1, or number 2. And for it to count, for them to get a point, they have to get 80% of them correct. So you could do it 5 times, and if they get 4 of it correct, then they earn themselves a 1. The final part of the exam, and potentially of most high yield, is the sacral exam. So this is sensory examination of the dermatomes on your buttocks and then the perianal area, both with light touch and pinprick, performed on both sides of the body. And then deep anal pressure, which is performed by inserting a gloved finger into the rectum and asking if they can feel it. And then the final part is testing the motor function of the external sphincter and asking them to contract their sphincter like they're holding in a bowel movement. That's called voluntary anal contraction. So I'm gonna go back to the exam, just point out a few other key factors. At the bottom here on the left-hand side of the screen, but you can see an area called voluntary anal contraction. You would fill that out as yes or no. And on the opposite side, it has deep anal pressure. You would fill that as yes or no. And I'm pointing this out because there's a key feature of this exam called the noon sign. And if someone has a no for voluntary anal contraction, a no for deep anal pressure, and all of the segments in S4 and S5 have zeros, it spells the word noon. And when someone has a noon sign, that means that no signal is getting from their brain to their sacral segments. They can't control a motor portion. And then no signal is getting from their perianal area to their brain. there is no sensation there. So no motor, no sensory signal going up and down the spinal cord. And that's defined as a complete spinal cord injury. So the ASIA impairment scale is when you hear people talk about A's, B's, C's, and D's is what we're talking about. So a complete injury is when there is no sensory or motor function in the S4 or 5 segments, the most bottom segments of the spinal cord. Now, that is the ASIA impairment scale that has the poorest prognosis for things like ambulation. And we're not going to get into prognosis. That's a whole talk in itself, and I'm happy to discuss that with people if they have questions. The next level is the ASIA impairment scale B, or sensory incomplete. Now, that basically means you have some sensation. It can be any of those sensations, light touch, pinprick, deep anal pressure, any sensation at the S4-5 segment. That means that sensation is getting from that area to your brain. The hallmark, though, is you don't have any motor in the S4-5 segment. So that's called an ASIA impairment scale B, and that's sensory incomplete. Slightly better prognosis, but not a whole lot better for ambulation. The key here, though, is moving to the next one. This is motor incomplete. So this is where you have some level of voluntary anal contraction. So motor function in the S4-5 segment, or you have motor function more than 3 levels below what you've determined to be the motor level. Now, the motor level is the highest area where the motor function is normal and everything above it's normal. And I don't want to get into too many details about it, but the key here is in motor incomplete, you can move some amount more than 3 levels below your level of injury. That's the key here. So you can, these patients have a better prognosis when it comes to regaining strength because they start with strength. So instead of starting at zeros, they're starting at ones, twos, threes, fours, or fives, and can hopefully turn that into functional movements. So that is the very, 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 very brief discussion about the ASIA impairment, INSCI examination and the ASIA impairment scale. Again, feel free to ask any questions. It's a challenging exam to learn. And not so much learn the exam itself, but how to score it. There is many resources you can go to. You can go to the ASIA, ASIA website, and they have learning modules. And you know, when you get into your residency and you do your spinal cord rotation, really, really delve into this and learn this, because this impacts how you talk to a patient, how you explain their prognosis, and what type of recovery they can expect. So very, very important part of spinal cord injury. But that's all we're gonna really talk about for today. So that brings us to us. What can we actually do? What can we as physiatrists do? You know, what's the cure? And unfortunately, this time, you know, we don't have a magic shot or a pill or a surgery that can fix you. There's things that can improve a spinal cord injury patient, but we don't have the ability to take you back to before the injury and make you normal again. And that's okay. That's part of what rehab medicine is learning to maneuver your life with the deficits that you have in the best way you can. Our job is to give these people the best chance at a healthy and happy life. So there is no cure. The word cure, patients always ask, what's the cure? And I don't know if that's a cure is such a challenging word. We know that patients have goals and they're optimistic, and that is fine. And we want them to reach and strive for those goals. So they have goals. We know that there is an abundance of new research and, techniques and medications and surgical interventions, which we'll touch on, geared at making these people better. And right now, that's all it is, though, is research. The thing that we do know works, the one thing we know can improve the outcome in a spinal cord injury patient, is having them complete acute inpatient rehab. And that is the hallmark of how to make a patient's life better. So what do patients... So about 10 slides ago, I showed you a whole list of complications and side effects of spinal cord injury. While in the acute phase of a spinal cord injury, you are at risk of all of those things, a very high risk of those things. And by coming to an acute rehab facility where you have a trained physiatrist, our job is to prevent those complications, prevent them from getting pressure injuries and limb contractures and DVTs. So by coming to rehab, we can prevent those and allow them to have a better outcome long term. Another really important hallmark of acute rehab and any diagnosis, but particularly spinal cord injury, is doing family teaching, teaching the caregivers how to move the patient so that they don't hurt themselves or hurt the patient, teaching the family what to look out for to make sure nothing's wrong. We have therapists who can do equipment evaluations, not just say, here's a wheelchair, but get them the correct equipment that's going to protect their skin. It's going to allow them to maneuver in their environment and be the happiest they can be. You know, I think of, like we talked about with that young patient and the sexual dysfunction earlier, it's an opportunity for patients to see a doctor every day who knows what they're talking about, hopefully, and ask challenging questions, questions that have tough answers. These patients are very vulnerable, both physically and mentally. They're scared, they're maybe alone, they can be depressed. And just by being there for them, we have an opportunity to uplift them and hopefully motivate them. That's a huge part of medicine and rehab medicine is motivation. And this is the time to motivate them, right? Because we know that in the first 3 months following a spinal cord injury, that is when you have the highest rate, the fastest rate of recovery happens in that time period. So if we can motivate them and take advantage of that acute recovery phase while they're in the hospital, in the gym, doing therapy, the sky's the limit, right? We need to get these patients optimized in the gym and motivated so we can give them every opportunity we can to succeed. And that is why I went into spinal cord medicine. That is why some of the people you hear about in spinal cord medicine, that's why they do it, so that they can be a part of this acute rehab and be there for the patient. So, you know, having prognosis discussions with patients is challenging because we don't have an answer as to how we're going to fix them, but we can make them better by going through what we just covered. And fortunately, there is a future, and the future is bright. There are hundreds of research studies, real research studies at very reputable institutions on how to prevent spinal cord injuries from getting worse immediately after the injury and prevent the secondary cascade of injury. And the future is bright. And some of the things that are available right now, not just, you know, 10 years from now, we're going to cover. But before we get to that, I wanted to show you some pictures. This is spinal cord injury treatment from about 400 BC. The devices you're seeing here are traction devices, primarily designed by Hippocrates. Spinal cord injuries have been around since people have been around. And I believe the first thing I've read, what I read was the first time it was ever described is like back in like 3000 BC by the Egyptians. And it described patients, people getting injured and not moving their legs and then dying very quickly. So 2000 years later, Hippocrates designed these devices that apply compression and traction and, you know, they're crazy looking, but we use some of the same techniques today, traction and, you know, there's a bunch of different things, but this is what we started with and these are some of the things we're at now. So at the very top of the screen, you can see the gentleman in black. He's utilizing something called an exoskeleton. By the way, I have no financial disclosures. I don't work for any of these companies. I'm going to try and avoid their brand names. But this exoskeleton is a robotic-powered skeleton that you can strap to your legs. And it provides a motor component. It can provide support and propulsion power. So folks who have some level of strength, this isn't great for people with complete injuries, but those incomplete injuries we talked about can have some meaningful ambulation and an ability to walk. These are available. People in the VA can get them covered through the VA. They are available in acute rehab hospitals. They are expensive though. On the left-hand side, you can see a gentleman in green who has called a dynamic body weight support system. And the interesting and exciting thing about this is the device itself can get installed on a tract. And this is for acute rehab. This isn't something you're necessarily going to go home with. It gets installed on a tract and patients can walk through a gym while being supported. And that support can be adjusted in many, many, many ways. It can support a certain amount of weight. Like you want to decrease this guy's weight by 50 pounds. It can do a percentage. It can sense when you're falling to keep a patient from falling. You can turn off that sensing so you can allow them to practice sitting and standing. And the great thing about this is it allows, as you can see, really one therapist to do the work because there's so much less risk of the patient hurting themselves. Now, just because this technology exists does not mean research shows that patients have unbelievably better outcomes, but it can get patients out of the bed earlier, which has its own mental health impacts, and it can improve the ability of therapists to function in a hospital. So if there's just one therapist with this patient, the other therapist that would potentially normally be with that patient can be also caring for other patients. So those are two areas of technology that are newer and are very exciting. Now, the one in the bottom right-hand corner is something I'm very passionate about. This is called TDCS, or transcranial direct current stimulation. And we won't go into details about the mechanism, but the gist is you apply these electrodes to the scalp. The electricity alters the resting membrane potential in your motor cortex. And over time, if you use this device with focused upper extremity training, there may be the potential to improve how the signal travels from your brain through your injured spinal cord, and you might get a better outcome from a strength standpoint. So I've been performing research in this. Kessler Rehab Institute has multiple research opportunities in this, and it's something that I am very excited about. As we move into the next slide, I have a few patient photos and videos. So George, if you don't mind stopping the recording, I do have